Yeah, okay, there may be a little. Okay, never mind.
He didn't want to finish that statement.
No, I don't think that statement needed to be finished.
Deep, off-the-record thoughts from Zane, Simon, and I, but we'll bypass that. Hi, Internet. It's Dallas and Zane from BloodyElbow.com. We're going to buzz through the Bellator 133 fight card this Friday, headlined by Alexander Shlemenko versus Melvin Manhoef. Zane, two-pronged question. How are you, and what are your thoughts on the card?
Awesome crap. Yeah, I mean, it's okay. It's maybe not crap, and maybe I'm not that awesome. I don't know. Everything's okay. All told, it's just like a broad sort of feeling.
Immediate back panel.
All rightness. Yeah, no, I'm doing well, you know. Things are good. The card is interesting. It looks like they are going through... It looks like they are hitting a really rough patch of how to fill their cards, honestly. I mean...
Which is weird, right? We were talking about that before.
Yeah.
Should be the opposite.
Yeah. Like, you have less cards and you had a huge roster. Why should, like, that kind of contraction? I realize they've been releasing some people, but you would still expect every show should be all of the, like, a bunch of feature fighters for every single one. You're only running 16 shows a year, you know?
Yeah, so I guess just as an overview, Bellator used to run seasonal, and once they kicked in, they would run a show every damn week for, like, 12 weeks straight. And when Scott Coker took over, he wanted to go away from that format, the thought process being... And it would be tough. I mean, if you have a show, you know, so imagine the Bellator staff, they're flying, you know, to New Mexico, to Ohio, Oklahoma every single week and setting up a full-blown show. So if someone pulled out, and I would always say the toughest thing for Bellator when compared to the UFC, if a fighter withdraws, especially on short notice, they don't have this vast pool of talent that they can, you know, seek replacements from. So... I mean, I think it's everyone kind of expected if they were going to space out their shows more, they were going to be a little more stacked up. And, you know, I mentioned this beforehand, even if this would have been a main card show during the Bellator seasonal 12-week blitz, this would still be not exciting, bordering on perhaps a piss-poor main card. Yeah?
Yeah, pretty much. I mean, especially just when, like, and I assume that the next one, Bellator 134, is a big tentpole event, as they're calling it, because it's, you know, titled The British Invasion, and it's, but, like, you look at those two next to each other, and it's like, you know, even if half, you took half that undercard and used it to fill out this card, getting, you know, Tamden McCrory and Brendan Ward or something like that on here, you would instantly have at least something more like even a classic Bellator weekday show.
Yeah, and it's a little, not to be anticlimactic, but normally we look for certain gems on the undercard, and I think we've both kind of decided it's not horrendous, but we're gonna pass over that. There's no really bright spots worth mentioning. But yes.
Not that I know offhand, and you know I've been looking for prospects for a lot of divisions now. You know, I've been looking for guys at welterweight and at light heavyweight and, you know, all that, and I'm just not seeing a lot on featherweight, and I'm just not seeing anybody on here that I'm really like, oh no, I recognize that guy from when I was just doing a bunch of scouting, and he looks like somebody to watch out for. So yeah, I'm not, you know, I mean, we could have dug through everybody and watched tape on everybody, but it just doesn't feel worth it for this.
In perhaps what, so let me just list off the main card on Spike TV. Four bouts: Chris Honeycutt versus Clayton McFarlane, Gabriel Holloway versus Julia Budd, Daniel Veitchel versus Pat Curran, and Alexander Shlemenko versus Melvin Manhoef. I think the first two are somewhat, call them spotlight fights, and Chris Honeycutt's deserving. I mean, that's a guy that I think deserves a little attention, but I think they're doing the same with Julia Budd, but neither are really sizzlers, if that makes sense. So I think when you put two of those on there, all of a sudden 50% of your card is a little bit of a spotlight fight with guys or competitors, I should say, since half of them are female, that maybe have the potential, but right now do not have the drawing power. So, and the competition that they're facing is fairly unknown and inexperienced. Half your card right there is lacking, you know, anything magnetic towards fans, especially new fans. I mean, I think they'd be lucky to draw in hardcores with that. Just me?
Yeah, I mean, you have to be hoping that both Honeycutt and Bud absolutely crush their opponents. Like, that has to be the hope, because if they just grind out three-round decisions for against each, then you really haven't gotten anywhere. And you've, you know, sucked a lot of energy out of a card that, quite frankly, could be three-round decisions all the way up to the main event, which will probably then end in under a minute. So you could, you know, it could be one of those cards where people are just like bored, and then suddenly the big fight that everyone's excited for comes up and it's over immediately, and that's not exactly how you want your card to go.
Yeah, and that brings up a decent point. Julia Budd is not a poor finisher. I don't know if I would call her a super strong finisher. I don't know if, you know, what your thoughts are there. And kind of the same with Honeycutt. So he's finished 4 out of 5. So either way.
Their top control, like, you know, they get on guys and they try to work them over and finish them that way. And, like, that's good, but it's not like the kind of dynamic performance where if it doesn't work perfectly, fans aren't watching that and going, oh, my God, that was amazing, you know?
Yeah, totally agree. Well, unlike a lot of our past Bellator shows, we do have betting odds to prattle off for all four of the main card fights. So you want to jump into these four, analysis-wise?
Sure.
Opening up the Spike TV broadcast, Chris Honeycutt, undefeated, phenomenal wrestler, coming off a win over Aaron Wilkinson. He takes on Team Explode's Clayton McFarlane. Do you want to do the honors on Mr. McFarlane's past competition, or shall I?
Sure, I can. The moment you hear Team Explode, that should be like an alarm bells are ringing moment, you know. And there are fighters that come out of that team whose records are at least passable and who even go on to success. It's not quite a barometer of career success. You know, for every Deshaun Johnson who gets to the UFC and flames out immediately, there's Robbie Peralta who gets to the UFC and sticks around for quite a long time and competes pretty well. But Clayton McFarlane's career thus far, he's 4-0, but it's the kind of 4-0 that should not... He's basically never fought before at this point. You know, he's got a win over Felon Fleming, who is, you know, but A, that name sounds made up. I can't believe there's somebody out there named Felon Fleming.
That's a Deacon Justin sponsor. But he's 0-10. Deacon Justin sponsors are going to be swarming him.
Yeah. He's 0-10. Demarius McDaniel, 0-4. And, you know, that leaves his lone win over fellow Explode product Ben Koshaba, who was in his debut and has only fought a similar level of competition afterward. So, you know, seeing that guy is 4-1, it's not like he's not 4-1. These guys are basically not – they're basically amateurs. Like, that, those are amateur fights at best.
Well, you could even say worse. I think you missed one in there, 0-1. So his last opponent is 4-1. So upon first glance, that's not too shabby.
His first opponent, not last.
Was it his very first? I thought his last opponent. Either way, so he's fought four opponents. Only one, not only has a winning record, has ever won in MMA. Three of his opponents are completely winless. 0-4, 0-10, 0-1. So that makes for a combined record for his opposition of 4-16. So it's just not impressive, you know what I mean? I mean, that just seems like a clear squash match for Honeycutt. And it almost makes it even more disappointing, because if we're going to showcase the guy, let's showcase the guy as being legit, having the skills to hang with good competition.
Well, and the thing is, is that I would say this, you know, if we're actually talking about the fight itself as it's going to go, McFarlane is not a bad prospect. You know, dude was like a high school wrestler. He may have wrestled at the collegiate level even. I'm trying to see it. He wrestled at, you know, he wrestled at a decent level. He's coming out. He looks like a physical wrestler, you know, great physically imposing frame. And he technically, like, he looks like he has the basic skills. He just he hasn't fought at a professional level yet.
Yes,
that's the thing.
So it goes back to, let me just clarify, to both Team Explode and their fighters, it doesn't mean they're all poor by any means, but to your comment of alarm bells go off, it makes them worthy of maybe a little scrutiny. So yeah. At this point, Clayton McFarlane, you know, he's fine. There's nothing poor I have to say about him other than being, you know, a 4-0 guy. You know, so pretty inexperienced, seriously inexperienced when we're talking about the top level of MMA, which is what Bellator wants to be. Some fans consider them. And it to me, that just makes him more of a question mark because he's 4-0 against, you know, combined four guys who have one win. Or I'm sorry, four wins, and that was one opponent. So I'm not knocking on Clayton McFarlane whatsoever, but, I mean, that past, you know, record, you have to kind of factor that into his skills. It's easier to look better against guys who have never, you know, won a fight before.
Yeah, it just, it means that the chances of him beating Honeycutt are slim. He could be competitive, but you can't really expect to walk in against somebody who's a pretty legit prospect and who's already now, you know, won at least one decent fight over a known opponent when he beat Aaron Wilkinson. You know, just you like, you don't know what to expect at that point out of yourself even, because you're not being tested against people who are going to challenge you.
And Honeycutt, I think we should give him some love because I've been pretty impressed with him. Especially in his first, you know, I think there was a lot of eyeballs on him more so than ever in his last fight, but he looked really good. He looked smooth. He looked like a mixed martial arts fighter, not as a wrestler trying to understand the game. He still got a long ways to go, but as anyone would with, what, six fights, he's 6-0?
He's 5-0.
Five, and actually we've seen some other, like if you contrast him to like Bubba Jenkins, I think Honeycutt has done just as well, or perhaps maybe even a little better. I'm not talking level of competition, but as far as his comfort as a mixed martial artist, phase shifting, you know, not holding a wrestling stance, holding a decent striking stance, being able to change levels fluidly and go for takedowns, and then his ground game, he might have been able to come into MMA Raw and look that well because of his wrestling accolades, but he looks smooth on the ground, good positional understanding, seems to understand now, or be more poised with a submission grappling lens to look for better positions, submission opportunities. So, you know, I'm pretty impressed with him.
Yeah, he looks good. And, you know, to what we were just saying about McFarlane and, you know, the idea, too, that bad competition doesn't necessarily make you less talented. It's not like Honeycutt fought anybody good before he got to Bellator either. You know, I mean, he wasn't fighting for Explode, so some of the guys he fought were at least like more in that regional journeyman role where they win and lose a lot, but they fight a lot. But it's still, you know, neither of these guys were starting their career in the deep end of the pool. So, you know, for him to look good in his first fight against serious competition against Aaron Wilkinson, you don't know what we don't know what we're getting out of McFarlane here.
Yep. All right. So I'd say we covered that pretty well. And, you know, our thoughts are mirrored on the betting lines. Minus the biggest favorite on the card, Honeycutt, that is, minus 600 on three sites and as high as minus 650 on one more. McFarlane, the underdog, at plus 390 on two and plus 440 on another.
That's interesting. Like, I don't understand that, but that's a name bet. Like, those are the name odds to me, because Honeycutt hasn't done, you know, he looks good, but he's not done enough at this point to say, like, oh, he's just going to wash anybody, you know?
I'd say name odds, but I think when you have a guy with his wrestling credentials, that also is a good way to give him like an extra, and deservedly so. I mean, I don't want to launch into the whole wrestling and MMA thing, but if you're damn good at wrestling, that I think that makes for a much more safe, it makes you a little more comfortable, you know?
Yeah, but I mean, it gets back to what we were talking about with Bubba Jenkins too, you know, like, and him taking that bad loss he did early in his career. You know, it's like that early and against that little competition that he's faced, it's so tough to be like, oh, this guy's just going to work over anyone who you put in front of him.
Didn't we all pick him correctly to lose in that last fight too? Who was that that he fought? Georgie?
Oh, he fought, yeah, he fought Georgie Karkanyan. Yeah.
And Georgie looked good too.
Yeah, wasn't Jenkins like actually a favorite going into that fight?
Yep.
Which I think was just ridiculous.
We were like, all a little surprised. And actually, I don't hold that against Jenkins at all, because no. Georgie is, I mean, exponentially more experienced and more well-rounded. Actually, in that loss, Jenkins, I thought, looked pretty good, so my respect did not waver for him. If anything, I think he might have some staying power. So
yeah,
I was talking
about his LaRue Burley fight. That was my point. Yeah. Was
I think I was live for that one. It was not a good fight either. All right, let's move forward. Julia Budd, former Strikeforce and Invicta fighter, taking on Gabriel Holloway. Julia Budd, I think this tagline has always followed her. I believe it's true, although I can't confirm it. The only fighter to defeat Gina Carano in Muay Thai?
Yeah, I believe that is true, yeah.
Which is highly, highly impressive.
Yeah, she was a very good kickboxer, Muay Thai kickboxer in Canada, and Canada's got a very good regional scene for Muay Thai and kickboxing. I think the weird thing to me is just that we never see that from her in MMA.
Like, I mean, you see some of her striking, but she does not come off as a pure kickboxer.
I've never seen her beat somebody with her striking in MMA. Like, just go out and be like, I'm just going to put it on you standing up and beat you and take the win that way.
No striking clinics, no highlight reel.
No.
Knockouts,
she's much more a wrestling and ground and pound sort of power top control fighter.
And on that topic, I'm not sure if that's a good or a bad thing. I mean, I guess I can see both sides. One, you could say she's maybe not maximizing her true strength. On the other side, you could say she's not one-dimensional. She understands and is proficient in the other areas, you know, the other phases of combat being clinching and grappling. Your thoughts?
Yeah, it's not like, I mean, it's working for her, so it's hard to say, like, turn around and say, oh, well, you should be doing this better because what she's doing is working. It's just one of those things where it would be like, you expect to see it a little. At least, like, when those opportunities come up and when she's in the striking exchanges, you expect her to see her really dominate there and then, like, go to the ground, stuff like that. And you just don't, like, she just never really even seems, like, super comfortable there. It's always, like, I'm just in a rush to get into the clinch, get the takedown, and work my top control.
Interesting choice of words, too, because she does seem, maybe that's what it is she seems a little bit in a rush to get out of the striking phase.
Yeah.
Which seems odd. But, I would say, well, I don't think this is really that subjective. Three main fights that her biggest fights and probably, you know, most likely what fans remember her for. A loss to Amanda Nunes, her second MMA fight, first round KO in Strikeforce. It's very surprising. At least I was really surprised at the time. She came back with a win over Jermaine de Randami, who had beat her in kickboxing. And that's an opponent in a matchup where I thought it was extremely wise for her to not stand and slug. I think that was the difference. Her clinch and grappling won her that fight. She followed up with her last and second loss in MMA, which was some gal named Honda Rousey. Armbar. First round armbar. No shame in that whatsoever.
No, I mean... I honestly, I don't even remember any of those fights at all at this point.
They were all on Challengers cards.
For her Invicta run. But
yeah, so she had 1, 2, 3, 4 strike force fights, and then the rest of her fights were all in Invicta.
Yep. And you know, her Invicta run was not that thrilling. And then she hasn't fought for now over a year. And she had a
Ooh,
it
yeah.
looks like it sounds
December of 2013 was their last fight.
Yeah.
And she won all of her Invicta fights. Actually three finishes, but not really over notables, we'll say. Notable opponents.
No.
So maybe is the big picture here, Bellator is getting back into women's MMA.
Mm-hmm.
This is, you know, I would say a good step, but you know, I don't know where it's going to go now. For a while, they had a really good thing going with Megumi Fuji and Zoila Gurgel / Frosto, and that all fizzled out. And I understand now wanting to get back into it, but it's going to be a tough one, name-wise. If they can secure Cyborg, that's your Willy Wonka's golden ticket to get there.
Yeah, I have nothing but criticism for the way Bellator handled their women's MMA the first time around. Like, I get that there's like a, oh, well, they were one of the first people to put it on and make it public and, like, do it, and that's great. But the way they eventually handled it was just, like, this, you know, sticky contract sideshow where once every year they'd put on a fight between two women, and it'd be on like an undercard, and that would be it.
No continuity, and I do respect them for being, you know, I think that differentiated them because they did the tournaments, and they were putting on women's fights when Dana White was in the no woman will ever fight in the UFC era. But they didn't, you know, they had to just kind of dip their toes in the water, and I think that came back to bite them because there was no continuity. You know, they would fight very sporadically, to say the least. So who knows? I do hope that they can develop that a little bit. Marluce Konen came back, had a good win, and she's solid. Yep. I, you know, she's an excellent, one of my favorite female fighters to watch. So hopefully they can make something of that. Let's see, Julia Budd, pretty close to Honeycutt as far as a huge favorite, -535 to -550. Gabriel Holloway, +400, +325. A few sites. We didn't really talk about Holloway that much. Do you want to give us your rundown?
The odds make sense to me. I think, you know, Holloway looks like she, you know, she moves well and she doesn't seem unathletic, but she has a style that's very similar to Bud in that 90% of what she's doing is looking to get the fight to the ground and work top control. And at this point, Bud has proven herself to be really strong and really consistent there, so it's hard to look at somebody like Holloway who hasn't faced nearly the same level of competition and say, oh, well, she's going to have success implementing the same game plan.
So I didn't watch any tape on Holloway, but I would have to, you know, agree with your assessment. Should be a tough matchup for her. I know she fought in XFC for a while. She's 4-1. Let's see, 1-1 in her last two, and two finishes, one TKO, one submission, two decisions. So, 5, and she's 5'3". I want to say Bud's a little taller than that, right?
Bud is way taller than that. Bud is
so.
I actually have seen Bud in person at a show up here in the Northwest, and
5'8".
She's like, I mean, she's listed at 5'8". So yeah, she's really. Was like watching some Amazon drift around the room. You know, she's like cornering one of her fighters and was like, seemed like she was way bigger than the guy.
So, Holloway, not as experienced in general, not even close to as experienced as far as past opposition, and she's going to be facing a 5-inch height disparity. So, tough matchup for her. Let's move forward. Daniel Vichel. He won the last featherweight tournament, correct? Beat Des Green in the finals?
Yes, correct.
Really crafty, underrated German fighter. Owns a past submission win over Dennis Seaver.
Yep.
I think he poses quite a threat to Pat Curran. And, man, I was as high as you could be on Pat Curran for a while. You have to make the correlation to some of his mental struggles, wouldn't you agree? Because he's been just up and down, and he seems to be two different fighters in there. So I'm actually pretty intrigued by this matchup because they're both three-dimensional fighters, pretty well-versed, striking, grappling, and wrestling. I would probably give Curran the slight edge in all of those areas, but Vaichel has that kind of patient, methodical, he won't be in a rush. He's a really tough guy to mount offense on. So I'm actually fairly intrigued at this matchup, and I think it could turn out to be really competitive. Is that just me?
Yeah, I think it'll be competitive. I mean, I think naturally, if I'm looking at this from like a career progression standpoint, Curran should win this fight. He's the guy who's still in his prime. He's got a lot less wear on him. He's been competing at a high. They've both been competing at a high level for a long time. I mean, Vaichel, he has a win over Frodo Kospalaev too. And
what the hell ever happened to Frodo?
He's stuck in Russia with visa issues, and Bellator was. It sounded like they were going to release him, and then they're not, and it's just kind of a mess, as far as I can tell. But both guys, but Vaichel's a guy who's been around since like 2002. He's been around just forever, kicking around the European scene, and he's done well lately. And his win over Des Green, I think, was especially surprising. Like, I don't think. If you were drawing it up on paper, that's not a fight that Vaichel wins at the time.
That was huge, and I was really surprised.
Yeah, and that makes this bout a lot more intriguing and a lot closer than I would otherwise think. Because otherwise, if I'm just looking it on paper, I'm like, okay, Vaichel's a seasoned vet, but Kern's really good. He's fighting really, generally been fighting really well. Even, in his losses, they weren't, like, horrible. He's just... seems like something is not clicking, but he should still beat Vaichel. But if something's not clicking and Vaichel's fighting as well as he is, it's a really hard fight to pick. I mean, my natural inclination now going in is I should pick Vaichel because he's the fighter on a roll. How it actually plays out, I'm not sure.
And I'm not either. And the mentality of both these guys, they like to, they're more of counter fighters, not just counter strikers. They both tend to... Curran, it's 50-50, but he definitely has shown the ability to be tentative, if not, just really defensive. Mm-hmm. And I have no idea, like, how this fight's the interplay. Who's going to be the aggressor if they're both going to hang back and wait? I would actually like to see one of them kind of break tradition and come out really, really aggressive, not reckless, but I don't think either guy is going to be expecting that. I think... And that's really not what fans crave, but I think this is going to be a methodical chess match. Both these guys, when they get off, I mean, excellent striking, fast hands, pretty dynamic. I've been really impressed with Vaichel's box and his work inside the pocket. And actually, Curran has struggled a little inside the pocket. Mm-hmm. I think he's at his best when he's in and out. And yep. Vaichel's not afraid to stay in the pocket and bob and weave and form his counters from there. So, not sure what to expect. By any means, I mean, winner, loser, or whether this is going to be a real high-paced, exciting fight, because once these guys are engaged, they could scramble, it could be back and forth on the feet, or this could actually be a really slow-paced decision.
Yeah, I think I'm going to have to go with Curran, just because I think a big part of Vaichel's game is based around whether or not he can get and maintain top control. Like, a lot of how he ends up winning is the ability to get guys on the ground, get them scrambling and making mistakes, and then get the back and get a submission. I'm not sure that the rest of his game is really, like, even when he's good and can get in the pocket and box as well, I'm not sure that he could maintain that for round after round without that center point of, like, and I'm going to get you on the ground and force you into bad positions and force you to scramble and force you to work off your back. And I'm not sure he can do that against Curran. Of all the things that he might be able to have success with, mostly in his inside boxing, I don't think he'll have that much success out-wrestling or holding Curran down. And at that point, I think I got to give Curran the edge in being able to win the fight.
I think Curran deserves the edge, almost in every category, which doesn't sound fair to Vaichel, but I think he's fought better competition, and I think even though they're both three-dimensional, Curran has shown a little bit more venom and technique in all three categories. I think, and that's a good point you brought up, because I think Vaichel's boxing is dangerous as soon as he shoots that takedown, because then all of a sudden his opponents are back on their heels, they're not sure what to look for. I think Curran's definitely the better MMA wrestler, but I think Vaichel can be opportunistic. So if Curran comes in and gets a little predictable with his combinations, if Vaichel can change levels and hit a reactive takedown, make it or not, that will be enough to put a little doubt in Curran's mind or a little hesitation. And I do think Vaichel, if he does get on top of Curran, again, might not be exciting, but I think it would be smart for him to base down and hold position and really maximize that top control time. Because, shit, I mean, if you can get that and ride out a round, that's usually a round in your favor in the books and what should be a pretty competitive fight.
Yeah, it's true. It's a tough one to pick.
And I'm looking forward to it, too. Curran is the favorite. A little bit steep for my taste, but understandable. Minus 245 to minus 270. Vaichel the dog at plus 190 as an average across the board. That's not too... I mean, I guess I can understand that. I might make it a little bit thinner, but I can live with those odds. You too?
Yeah, that's fine. I understand why Curran would be the favorite, but it's not terrible.
All right, moving on to the main hurrah. Alexander Storm Shlemenko. Coming off a couple shaky performances, and not really performance. They all seem to be mentally related. We'll get into that a little more, but squaring off against Melvin Manhoef, arguably the most technical kickboxer in MMA. I'm just throwing that out there, arguably. He's one of the better ones. Also coming off a knockout loss to glory fighter Pat Schilling. Stitch him up. This is another one where, man, I can see this going a million different ways. Why don't you lead us off on this one? How do you see this playing out?
All right. I don't know about Shlemenko and mental lapses so much as just that he's physically not really... Like, he's not really in a place to deal with guys that can actually muscle him around and take him down and are more technical wrestlers. It's just not his... style. It doesn't set up well for that, and he's never really seems to have prepared himself well for it. But Manhoef is certainly not going to be that guy. Like, we know that Manhoef is not going to go out there and wrestle Shlemenko, and in general, I think that makes this a really fun fight to make. This is sort of the classic strike force kind of fight, and they've been keeping Manhoef on that, and they haven't been keeping Shlemenko on it as much. But I don't know. I guess I feel like there's a part of me that just, like every Manhoef fight, he could end this in a minute or in 20 seconds, or he'll lose a fight that gets more involved and gets into more of a back-and-forth battle and gets into more of a, like, extended trade. I mean, I think there's a lot more signs that Manhoef's chin and that his, like... ability to take damage has faded than there is with Shlemenko, who just seems to physically maybe have lost a step. So it's kind of tough. Like, do you take Shlemenko having lost a step, or do you take Manhoef having not being able to take a punch as well? Which of those play out first?
Well, old school Melvin Manhoef, I mean, the fight could be over in 30 seconds, and it could have been a highlight reel knockout on his behalf, or he could get taken down and armbarred with the quickness.
Yeah.
And Shlemenko is not a takedown armbar kind of guy. let me real quickly clarify my mental lapse comment on him. So the two losses both did monstrous, and I mean monstrous, like light heavyweight size guys in Tito and... Shit, Tito's a heavyweight guy, but Brandon Halsey was the other one.
Yep.
With Tito, at first he started out doing an excellent job, because what you don't want to do is get clinched up, and the easiest way to get clinched up is to get trapped in the corner of the cage. He was using great footwork. There was a couple times, I want to say two times, Tito went to corner him, he threw a strike and immediately circled out into open space. The same thing happened right afterwards, and Tito came after him, and he stood there and planted and threw, and then still didn't, like, cut a hard angle. He planted again and threw another one, and Tito tied him up, and it was lights out from there. With Halsey, he got taken down early, and I can understand that, but he completely went defensive scramble with... I don't even want to say defensive. That seemed like a frantic, almost like a panic scramble, because he did a good job, got his hips loose, rolled over and turtled, but he had both arms posted on the mat with Halsey still connected, And, I mean, you got to be thinking any time since, like, the MMA first started, rear naked choke in that position. But he took both of his posted hands and never even fought the choke off as a preventative measure. And then once Halsey had it laced up, he still continued to try to get back to his feet, which to me, I mean, that seems crazy for a guy of his experience level, especially knowing that Halsey's best chance was exactly what he was doing. So, not being defensive, but that's just, to me, that was disappointing and more mental than physical. As far as this matchup, I think it's really interesting because Shlemenko usually almost always has a striking advantage over his opponents. He's rangy as well. So I guess what I'm getting at is, to me, the question is whether Shlemenko is going to stand up with him or whether Shlemenko is now going to be the one initiating clinches and takedowns.
I think even, you know, even when Shlemenko fought Hector Lombard and fought, like, a big guy with a bunch of power in the past, we never really saw a takedown Shlemenko.
Well, difference being Olympic judoka versus a guy who's notoriously weak in the takedown department.
Yeah, but it's still, like, I've never seen it. I've never seen a Shlemenko that works for top control.
I'm trying to think of a fight where he somewhat regularly pursued takedowns, and there's not one coming to mind.
Yeah, and at this point, I think if it was going to happen, it would have happened.
Yeah, like, whatever, like 60 fights deep, it could happen. You never know. You could pull that out. Well, then Tell me if I'm wrong here, but Shlemenko standing up with one of the most decorated kickboxers, he could get put to sleep here. Shlemenko's got a great chin. I would give his chin the advantage, you know,
yeah,
over Manhoef.
Yeah, that's the thing to me is the chin. Like, I could see, like, you know, maybe not to the quite the same poignancy, but I could see a Robbie Lawler, Melvin Manhoef kind of performance here, where Shlemenko is just getting beat on for a few minutes before he lands one big hard shot, especially like a spinning back fist or something that Manhoef doesn't see coming and that puts him out.
And Shlemenko hasn't really been a one-shot guy. I mean, it's been there, mostly with the spinning back fist or even the spinning back kick. He had that sweet sequence, where he finished Doug Marshall with that nasty hook to the liver. But he's mostly a guy who will chop you away rather than land the one big money shot, which is tough to do against Shlemenko. So straight MMA striking-wise, who do you give the edge to?
I don't know. Like, it's easy to say give the edge to Manhoef just because he's so exciting and he's so fun to watch when he wins. But he also, like, I mean, Shlemenko wins almost all the time when he's not facing somebody that's going to put him down on the mat and outwork him and, you know, just physically stay right in front of him and not be able to be chopped down. Like, Shlemenko wins. And so do I then bet on... Do you bet on Manhoef being a guy that can't be chopped down, that can't be hurt? Not, you know, that's hard to do. I got to take Shlemenko because I got to look at this as, like, am I betting more on Shlemenko's chin going away or on Manhoef getting caught, which he's classically been prone to?
And Shlemenko's has he ever been knocked out?
I don't think so, but he's fought a ton, so probably.
I think Lombard knocked him down, but not out.
Jordan Radaev knocked him out in 2009.
Yeah. Former UFC-er, Jordan, and he was more of a wrestler too, right?
Yeah, I believe so. And
wow,
then
that's surprising.
That's it. So, like, and that could probably be chalked up as like a flash KO. It happened in the first round. You know, one of those things where somebody just gets caught. I'd have to go back and watch the fight, but that doesn't, you know, obviously his whole career has been marked by the fact that he's got a fantastic chin. So, Manhoef is the kind of guy where that doesn't necessarily matter, but it's a lot easier to, if you have two guys who are going to find each other's chins, to bet on the guy who tends to stay conscious.
Yeah, so this is really tough because I actually think that Melvin's striking, his MMA striking is phenomenal, because we've seen kickboxers come over, they have the finesse and the technique, but often they lack just the raw brutality. You know, I mean, it's a fucking fist fight at the end of the day. Or we've seen vice versa, good strikers who are brutal and rugged and powerful, but they don't have the overall polish. And I think Manhoef has a phenomenal blend. I hate to speak in absolutes, but I can't think of a lot of guys who have his combination of technique, footwork, balance, and raw power. I mean, it's really, really super rare. Guys like, did I say Pat Schilling before? Joe Schilling. Sure, but I mean, that's why he's in the glory ring. And even in the glory by kickboxing standards, Schilling is he's a mean bastard. He's a rugged dude. So to me, I think if they, in his Manhoef's chin is the big X factor in there. Even though Shlemenko isn't really a one-shot guy, for a gunslinger who's going to stand up and live by the sword, die by the sword, being on the feet, his chin has to factor in there. So offensively, Melvin's awesome. Defensively, and his chin, there's a little bit of a liability there. Either way, I think if they stand up, that barring, Shlemenko pulling out the big bazooka, that Manhoef is going to do really well. So I actually, I don't know how to word this, expect, or if I was Shlemenko, I would mix in some clinch work and some grappling, if nothing more than to throw Manhoef off.
Yeah, you say it every time, and sometimes it happens. I just don't, like... And he may at least like look for some takedown, some sort of like sambo kind of like I'll dump you really quickly and then we'll keep you off balance kind of thing. I don't know. I mean, I'm picking Shlemenko either way. I think that it's a bad kickboxing match, but I think it still matches up well for him in an MMA bout, even as good as Manhoef is. Because you look at a lot of the guys that Manhoef has actually successfully KO'd in the cage, and there have been a lot, but like most of the strikers, most of the guys who've been really looking to stand and bang with Manhoef that he's knocked out are guys that get knocked out a lot. You know, the guys like Evangelista Santos, Doug Marshall, Dennis Kang, Mark Hunt's like the one big exception of a guy that both likes to strike a lot and was really hard to knock out.
Everyone thought that was a work when he knocked him out with that short punch. That was a super, super Hulk tournament, right?
Yeah, and that was, Mark Hunt was just running like straight into it. He just walked straight into Manhoef's fist But, yeah, I mean, otherwise, when he's fought guys that are hard to knock out, guys like Tim Kennedy and Mamed Khalidov and other guys like that, he doesn't tend to win. And so, I don't know. Like, it just... I'm not seeing it.
There's some past Shlemenko fight, I can't think of who it was against in past, so like recent 3-4 years, he was really clinch heavy. Not necessarily looking for takedowns, but he was all over with knees and even short elbows in the clinch. Mm-hmm. But so, all right, so after we've talked this through, even if Melvin has, if I perceive him having some extent of an advantage on the feet, Shlemenko's chin has been awesome. He's more dynamic, so I'll probably go with Shlemenko too, but I do expect, or I hope at least Manhoef will give him some trouble and make this an exciting fight. Are you looking forward to this one? Because this is one of those, I don't care. I'm really looking forward to this one.
It's not like Shlemenko doesn't like to get hit. Like, Shlemenko puts himself in positions to take a lot of shots. He's not a defensive mastermind.
Yeah, you could say that about both of these guys, right?
Yeah, and so he, almost certainly this fight's going to be good because he's going to get hit, and Manhoef hits hard enough that, like I say, this fight could be... Shlemenko could go down in the first 30 seconds, and I would not be shocked. You know?
This is a three-rounder, right?
I'm not sure, actually.
I'm not either. That just came to mind. All right, check that out if you can. I'm going to rattle off the betting odds here. Shlemenko, the expected favorite, minus 285 across the board. Manhoef, the dog, at 205 to plus 225. Finding anything?
That sounds good. I mean, it's close, so...
That sounds about right, I would say.
It should be close because it's, when you get these really exciting striking fights, three rounds.
All right, so three-rounder. Well, that concludes, what we're going to talk about today. Do you have anything else to add?
No, I mean, it's a fight that, especially from a prospect perspective, I'm interested in watching Honeycutt. I'm interested in watching Bud. So that gets me a little interested. And then the top two fights are against experienced vets that are at least hopefully should be fun to watch. I think the big thing will be if the Kern Vichel fight is exciting. That's what a lot of the enjoyment of watching this event will hinge on.
Totally agree. And the UFC has had a couple events where really the main event and maybe the co-main event are by far the bright spots. And let's see, who was it? Aldo and Mendez. I want to say most of that show was not good. I mean, prelims all the way up to the main card, but then Aldo and Mendez had a great fight, and you didn't hear anything about it being a shitty event. And in a way, it wouldn't make sense for Bellator to capitalize on the, surefire slugfest between Shlemenko and Manhoef. So if they had a mediocre card in the works, maybe this is the right one to use it on.
It's true. It is a fight at the top that's likely to draw eyes no matter what's under it. It's just not much under it.
And I agree. If Vichel and Kern have a good fight and Shlemenko and Manhoef, do anything, other than, have something tragically boring or unexciting.
It's never, that fight cannot be boring. There's just no way. Both men, I think, would rather, go out on their shield before they put on a boring fight.
Barring a Kevin Randleman slipped on a pipe in the dressing room.
Yeah.
Just before the fight. All right, we're going to wrap it up. Go ahead and do your thing, your Twitter thing, and then you have a couple more shows coming up this week, correct?
All right, yeah. You can find me on Twitter at TheZaneSimon, and then we've got a World Series of Fighting Vivisection that'll be out tonight, and we'll be doing the UFC Vivisection tomorrow. We've got the MMA Prospectus on Friday coming up. We'll probably be doing a sixth round. So it's a big, busy week for video shows. Be sure to watch them all, like them all, share them all, all that good stuff.
Hump them all. Do everything to them. All right, I'm at Elkhorn Justice on Twitter, if you are so inclined. Otherwise, Zane's got the World Series of Fighting, and Zane and I and Connor will be back tomorrow for the UFC Vivisection. Until then, ladies and gentlemen, thanks for watching.